In this exercise, what we are going to do is imagine that we have a continuous function f, whose domain is the unit interval on the x-axis and whose range lives within the unit interval on the y-axis. So f is a continuous map from 0, 1 to 0, 1. With just this information, we would like to prove that f must have a fixed point, at least one. Such a point, which I'll call C, is fixed under the action of f, which means that f sends C back to C. In other words, let me just give you a couple scenarios. It'll seem redundant, but I'm leading to something. Perhaps f of 0 is 0. In that case, 0 is a fixed point. Or the other extreme, perhaps f of 1 is 1, in which case 1 is a fixed point. Or maybe f of 1/2 is 1/2, or f of 0.2 is 0.2, or f of 0.9 is 0.9. Okay. So if f sends an input back to itself, we call that a fixed point. Our goal is to prove that any such continuous function from 0, 1 to 0, 1 must have a fixed point. Let me sketch a picture of a continuous function. I might draw two or three later, but let's start with just one. Imagine f of 0 is, say, here, and it's continuous, so maybe it looks like this. All right, based on those scenarios that I was kind of laying out, all of the different ways that f might have a fixed point, take a moment to try to come up with an algebraic and also visual representation of what it looks like to have a fixed point. What I'm trying to lead you to is, what should I add to this picture to characterize fixed points? Where would I look for a fixed point for this particular function? This is a function which is continuous from 0, 1 to 0, 1, so we know it should have one fixed point at least. Where would I find that on this picture? What I'm hoping you realized is that the line y equals x that connects this corner to that one is a line of fixed points. So the function f of x equals x fixes every input. So let me see if I can draw a straight line. Okay, that's pretty good. Anytime a continuous function intersects the line y equals x, it intersects at a fixed point. So for this particular function, because y equals x, we can say f of c is c for this particular input. Okay, geometrically, that's what it looks like on the picture. I think it's fun to just experiment with this. So notice here, I drew a random continuous function. I don't have any closed form algebraic expression for this. I just got inventive as I was going from the left side to the right side. So take a moment to experiment with what continuous functions look like. So sketch a few, see if you can try to cross this diagonal more than once, and then try not to cross that at all. You won't be able to, but come up with like an intuition for why you cannot before we write down the actual proof that f must have a fixed point. All right, I hope that you creatively sketched a few functions kind of like this, where maybe you don't actually have a formula for the function that you drew. It's very important in mathematics to learn how to sketch whenever you can, to try to come up with conjectures and make observations and notice patterns. I only have one color left that I haven't used, so I'm not going to add lots more to this graph. But what are other ways that I could try to connect a function from x equals 0 to x equals 1 in a continuous fashion? Well, if I started at the origin, again, that would be a fixed point. So it's like, okay, don't start at the origin if you want to try to break the statement. And if I ended with f of 1 equal to 1, again, 1 would be the fixed point. So somehow I need to end not at that top right corner. Can I travel from this point to that point without crossing the line? And hopefully you did this enough to feel that you cannot. Okay, so you know, I can avoid it for as long as I can, but eventually, if I'm going to get from here to here, I'm going to have to cross the line. You might cross it more than once. So I said, draw a picture that has two crossings or three crossings, so you can kind of cross back and forth. This statement doesn't tell us how many fixed points f has, nor how to find them. It just tells us that f has to have at least one. Okay, assuming that you've studied the theorems of single variable calculus, this action of can I get from here? Sorry, let me pick that up. This action of can I get from here to here without crossing something should remind you of a very famous named theorem. So it's like, I want to travel from some point to another in a way which skips over something, or I want to show that I can't skip over something. So does that remind you of a very famous theorem? And if so, which one? The very famous theorem that I hope that you remembered was the intermediate value theorem, the IVT. What it tells us is that if I have a continuous function, which takes, say, this y value at some point, and then over here, it takes this y value, then for any y value in between those two, there has to be an input that sends me to that elevation. So it can't travel from here to here with a continuous function without crossing this pink dotted line. In fact, in this particular diagram, I cross it 3 times, but what the intermediate value theorem guarantees us is at least 1 crossing. So colloquially, it's like you can't go from the summit of a mountain to the base of the mountain without crossing every elevation in between. The trick is figuring out how to apply this theorem to this diagram, because here, what we are crossing is flat, whereas here, it's at an angle. So take a moment to just experiment with this idea. We want to create a function to which we will actually apply the traditional intermediate value theorem. So I'm not going to adjust my theorem. Rather, I'm going to adjust how we are analyzing this function so that we can apply, again, the regular intermediate value theorem. So take a moment and see if you can write down some way to kind of measure how our function is situated relative to the line y equals x. All right, if you figured out what function to apply the intermediate value theorem to, that's great. If not, let me show you my thought process with this problem. Looking at these 2 functions I sketched, or maybe 5 or 6 if I was working on paper, I need to detect when my function crosses this line. Or not really when, because we aren't going to find the value c, but we need to show that such a crossing must happen. So I would like to come up with a function that measures whether f is, say, above y equals x or below. So maybe this function that I invent, which isn't yet on the board, could be positive if f is above the line, so measuring like a positive distance here, and then it switches to negative when f is below the line, so that I can try to associate for my new function the value 0 as a crossing point. Okay, so that will be the function that we will create. Let me just jot it down here because we will actually set that aside for just a moment. In our proof, we will introduce the function g of x equals f of x minus x. The idea being that when f is above the line, this measurement here is positive. So just take the orange one. G is positive, positive, decreasing, but still positive. It's 0 right here, and then it's negative. Same thing for the green one. It's possible that your function crossed several times, in which case g changes signs. But if you compare the values of g for the left side and the right side, it should be going from positive to negative. You might not know how many times g changes signs, but you'll know it changes at least once. Okay, so this is going to be the key idea, but before we get there, let me knock out like one very special case, which is that either f of 0 is 0 or f of 1 is 1 or both, so that we know we actually have a fixed point if we just look at the lower left corner or the top right corner. Okay, so here's the proof. First, suppose either f of 0 is 0 or f of 1 is 1. Logically in math, when you say or, typically it doesn't mean exclusive or, it means and or. So this sentence allows us to imagine either f of 0 is 0 or f of 1 is 1 or both. So any of those behaviors is fine. Then automatically we found the fixed point. In this case, 0 is the fixed point. In this case, 1 is the fixed point. Okay. So if f of 0 is 0, c is 0. If f is 1, if f of 1 is 1, then c is 1. So here I'm trying to say respectively. And we're done. So we found our fixed point. Now suppose that f of 0 is not 0 and f of 1 is not 1. So the more interesting situation is the one that we've graphed here. Because f sends 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, we know that if f of 0 is not 0, it has to be greater than 0. And likewise, if f of 1 is not 1, it has to be less than 1. So our range is constrained here to live within the unit interval from 0 to 1. If not, f of 0 is greater than 0, and f of 1 is less than 1. Now I'm going to introduce our new function g. I don't want to write a lot about the fact that g is continuous. It is continuous. We need that to apply the IVT. It's the difference of two continuous functions. So f is continuous. The function y equals x is continuous. So g, as the difference of continuous functions, is continuous. I'm just going to state that. So define the continuous function. I'll be a little bit more rigorous. Just define the function. And notice it's continuous. Since it's the difference of two continuous functions. Moreover, let's see what happens when we plug in 0 and 1. So g of 0 is f of 0 minus 0, which by hypothesis is positive. That again is just measuring here that our function is above the line. And I think I'll squeeze it all on right here. G of 1 is f of 1 minus 1, which if f of 1 is less than 1, f of 1 minus 1 is less than 0. Again, detecting that our function is below the line. So this is really like figuring out who's above and who's below. Okay, let me step aside for a moment so that you can write down the last sentence. So we need now to take these two observations and extract from this that f has a fixed point. Our conclusion follows right now from the intermediate value theorem. G is a continuous function, which is above 0 on the left and below 0 on the right. So if you remember that kind of mountain diagram I sketched, it has to cross 0 for some value c between 0 and 1. So let's see, by the IVT, intermediate value theorem, there exists a C between 0 and 1 so that G of C is 0. But if G of C is 0, then F of C minus C is 0, so F of C equals C. thus, i.e., C is a fixed point. All right, so that wraps up the proof. I just think it's a very fun exercise in practicing, like taking a scenario, visualizing it, you know, testing it, test yourself, see if you can try to break it. First, what are you even trying to break? Detect the behavior. Here it was recognizing the importance of the line y equals x. And then once you realize, okay, this is the behavior I need to capture, I visually understand it, but how do I turn it into like a quantity that I can work with, something that I can actually apply a theorem to? Coming up with the function g is the next key idea. And from g, the rest of the proof follows pretty quickly. What I would like to do is take a moment to let you digest this, and then I want to come back and talk a little bit about the meaning here. So what is going on? How can we visualize this? Here's how I would like for you to think of this theorem. When we were sketching functions a moment ago, we graphed traditional looking functions where this was the domain and my range I imagined as a subset of the unit interval on the y-axis. But really, this is a function from the unit interval back into itself. So you could just imagine the result is living down here. So what I want you to picture is imagine I have 1 meter of rope and I pick this rope up and maybe I rotate it and I double it back on itself, but I lay the rope back down where it started. So perhaps, and I'm actually going to show you a MATLAB movie of this in just a moment, but perhaps I take the left end of the rope and I put it there, and then I go a little bit that way and I kind of double back and I put the right end here. So, you know, I'm just laying a piece of rope down on this unit meter on the ground. Some molecule of rope must return to where it started. So some piece of rope is fixed by my action because my action is continuous. I'm not cutting the rope up. So that's really what this is saying, is that with some nice continuous way of mapping this interval back to itself, some point has to return to where it started. This is called a Brouwer Fixed Point theorem. It's like a theorem, but it's really like a family of results kind of for different domains. Another visualization of it for, say, a two-dimensional domain is imagine I take a piece of paper and what I really care about here is like the left, right, up, down position of each little piece of paper. Imagine I take this paper and maybe I scrunch it up and I rotate it and I smooth it out or something like that. It doesn't have to go back to filling the entire space, but when I'm done acting on this paper in a way that doesn't rip it, the paper, the result of my, you know, scrunching is still here, still in this part of my screen. Some piece of paper has to go back to where it started. So I can't move every little morsel of paper to a new location. It's kind of cool, actually, because you can take that and think about, you know, if you are in some building, say you're on a floor of a building and you're holding a map, a blueprint of the building, somewhere on your map, you know, right where your feet are, somewhere on the map should be a point that corresponds in this kind of representation way on the map to exactly the real point on the ground. So if you think of the action of creating the map and having your map right here is like taking the actual floor and turning it into a blueprint, it's like shrinking it inwards. Some point has to be properly represented on the map is really like a red point. You would say you are here on your map. Okay, I don't think I said that very well, but I hope you understand what I'm trying to get at. So these are called fixed points theorems. And I wrote a script in MATLAB because I like to visualize this kind of thing with MATLAB. So what I will leave you with is a demonstration with a few different functions. I think most of them have one fixed point, but I think I have one with more than one fixed point where I'm trying to do the rope. So I have a piece of rope that goes from red to yellow. And what I'm going to do is imagine kind of lifting the rope into some configuration up here. You'll see it cast over here. I'll identify the fixed point for you, and then I'm going to map it back to the x-axis just to kind of give you that feeling that somebody had to go back to where it started. Okay, so that wraps up this exercise. I hope you enjoyed proving this and also thinking about it. If you'd like to read more, Brouwer Fixed Point Theorem is a whole well-known family of results, and you might enjoy learning about some of the ways to visualize the consequences with real-world objects.